it's very nice of you to come and sit in here. Is it okay if I turn this chair around and just kind of sit down and be a little bit less formal? So, it's very lovely to be invited. And in a way, I'm just going to come and tell you about experience, really, of the last, what really amounts to the last 25 years of working in agriculture as part of an organisation called Ruskin Mill Trust. And we deliver specialist education to young learners with learning difficulties. Learning disability, learning difficulty, learning difference is probably a better way of putting it. And the essence of it is really looking at their difficulties and why they can't access education in the mainstream. What is it that prevents them from learning like a so-called neurotypical person? And then finding ways of engaging people to actually overcome those barriers to learning. So probably one of the first things that we could do here this afternoon is just go into our imagination a little bit. So if you just imagine, if I might just get you to do something, if that's okay, if you're a small group and you look friendly. how about I talk to you and you all look in the other direction, because actually in your anxiety you actually can't look at another person. Yeah, so just turn your heads the other way and I'm going to just continue to talk to you just for a couple of minutes, or maybe for less than that. And just check in with the experience of what it's like to actually resist looking at another person who's trying to communicate with you. Yeah. So part of what we do is we take these young people, and very often they come with high levels of anxiety, and anxiety is debilitating. Anxiety can mean that actually the act of getting out of bed in the morning and having to have a conversation with a carer or a parent or a teacher is so anxiety, but you can look this way, this way. It's so anxiety causing that it's going to prevent you from actually having an interface with the world and being able to go about what we would describe as normal business. And you may then start to put some we could describe as kind of ritualistic behaviour in a way that prevents that from happening. Yeah? So you may have a diagnosis, let's say, of autistic spectrum disorder. And alongside that autistic spectrum disorder diagnosis, you may also have high levels of anxiety. And actually, anxiety now in the UK has overtaken depression as the leading mental health disability. One in four people are now registered with some form of anxiety at some point in their adult life, which is quite a startling figure, isn't it? It kind of tells you maybe something about the way we're approaching life as a society. Depression is another barrier to learning. So I'm going to just start with a little narrative. Okay, so I'm going to tell you, and this narrative will run throughout this talk. I'll pick up on it as we go through. And so a young man came to Ruskin Mill College, which is largely an agriculturally based college. And we have a farm, 45 acre farm, mixed farm, livestock, field scale crops, small kind of market garden, top fruit, soft fruit, small amount of covered crops, and then mixed livestock. And our cultivation is largely done with a team of working horses. Okay, so and the impulse there is that we are a biodynamic farm. So we work out Rudolf Steiner's principles of biodynamic agriculture. And then beyond the farm, there's then about 15 to 20 acres of coppiced woodland, so woodland which is managed in a traditional manner. And then beyond the fish farm, beyond the woodland is a fish farm. It's actually England's oldest fish farm. It was established in 1913, and it's the world's only biodynamically certified fish farm. And we grow traditional brown trout there, and the hydrology there has been organised in such a way that it supports the life cycle, the two-year life cycle of brown trout. And then just beyond that, we then have an area which we call valley landscape. And again, that's a small area of productive land where students are immersed in nature and landscape work and some small-scale kind of forest gardening, I suppose we could describe it as. So our whole 150-acre site is based around productive agriculture, but with an intention that it will have therapeutic benefits. So we have a young man who came to us, I think now 3 years ago, at the age of 17, and what we could call him was a serial self-harmer. So there was something in him, in his story, in his biography, in his history, that has caused him to feel so depressed that actually he needs to cut himself. And he's not an unusual type of person who we have coming into our college. And in a way, the chaos of the life that he was coming from travelled with him into our landscape. But the invitation is, actually, we'll come and see what happens when you meet us in this different landscape. So he's coming from the edge of the city and he's coming to rural Nailsworth on the edge of on the outskirts of Stroud. It's a very small town, 6,000 people. And actually our site is in a village next to Nailsworth. So what happens with him is that he's given the opportunity to experience something different for 8 hours of his day, where the chaos of his own life and the chaos of the surrounding environment is just put to one side for a while. And he has a particular issue in forming relationships. He has what can be diagnosed as a reactive attachment disorder. What happens in reactive attachment is that if a child in its in infant stages, so between the ages of 1 and 3 usually, doesn't receive basically love, but doesn't receive appropriate touch and holding and nurturing, and there's been neglect or recklessness, very often abuse, the brain produces cortisols from the what we could call the reptilian part of the brain, and those actually cause a reaction across the brain and they form channels. It's like water running across freshly tilled soil. It erodes, basically. And those channels then provide the kind of neurological route for reaction, hence reactive attachment disorder. So if the child has failed to make appropriate attachment to the caregiver, and the reaction is cortisol, which then creates what we know as fight, flight, or fright, freeze. Yeah? And very often, it's fight. That's what we need. So reactive attachment disorder prevents, actually, through the reactions in the brain, a young person from being able to form appropriate attachments, recognisable attachments. So if you join that together with another diagnosis of autistic spectrum disorder, which also prevents people from being able to make appropriate attachments, and very often is accompanied with compulsions as well, whereby actually that person finds it very hard to make a relationship with their environment, let alone another person. if you have those two pathologies working side by side, you have a young person who actually has a large amount of difficulty making attachment, making relationships. So this particularly young person, who's an example of many, comes in and causes chaos, absolute chaos. And the relationships that he tries to build are often of a nature where he's a little bit predatory, shall we say, on some of the female cohort of the student body. Probably because he hasn't been in the situation where he's been allowed to express himself before, because the other thing we have to take into account, this is an adolescent. This is a young 17-year-old guy who's away from home now, going to college. And it doesn't kind of forgive the behaviour, but it does also add to the mix. And so there was a large amount of chaos that was caused that involved certain people refusing to come to college while he was there, and him then having to spend some time away because allegations are made, and then you have to go through the whole process of investigating allegations, which with learners with special education needs, is actually very difficult to get to the bottom of an allegation. But what it does do is it provides an opportunity to kind of rebuild relationships and show that actually there's a body of professional people who care and actually want everybody to have access to the type of education that's taking place there. Anyway, over a period of time, a relationship is built with place. And this is one of our key fields. We work out of what we would call seven fields of practice. So we could say we work out of knowing the spirit of the place. And that sounds a little bit out there. Actually, what we do is we look at the regenerative possibility, the regenerative social possibility that the landscape holds within it. Yeah, so we kind of draw a historical map, in a way. And we look deeply into the geology of any of our centres, and we have 8 centres across the country. In our particular case, we're on an lytic limestone. We look at the faults that are in the limestone and how it's got there and what it does in terms of producing a soil, very shallow soil, very non-fertile soil. And then we look at the local flora, and we look over the neighbour's kind of hedge in a way, and we see what can be grown there. What does the land want to emit, in a way? How can we be productive? And then we also look at the fauna, we look at the animal life in the place, we look at the wildlife particularly, we want to know what's around, what birds are around, especially what the birds of prey are, the bats, for example, the small mammals, the insect life. We're really looking at the ecology that is prevalent in the place. And then what we do from having studied that really is we then look at the social history. And on our particular site, our social history, the wealth of our site, the Renaissance period for the Cotswolds, after the Romans had kind of moved on, was through the wool trade. So the Cotswold fleece was known to be the best fleece in the world in the 16th, 17th century. And the Italian wool merchants of Florence, who were basically funding the architecture and the art of Florence at the time, would buy the wool from the Cotswolds and they would sell it. And they would, as high quality cloth in Italy. So this trade between Florence and the Cotswolds was actually what generated the wealth. So we know that sheep have a very special significance to our place. Okay. Now this might sound a little bit wacky, but actually in terms of an emerging field which is now known as terra psychology, terra as in the earth, to terror psychology, the concept that a place can regenerate and can actually generate a reaction in people is becoming researched and becoming more widely recognised. And so this is something that we're researching as well, and we're working with. So this young person comes in, and his chaotic life is almost immediately not ameliorated, but kind of just aided to become a little bit less chaotic. And what's very prevalent in that is there is a very low level of stimulation. So if you're a young guy coming out of the city and actually it's all about what you look like, it's all about the adverts, it's all about your image, it's all about spending your time, screen time, it's all about substance abuse and all that kind of stuff. And you come into our college environment, actually the stimulation there is, the volume is turned down, we could say. And what you have in front of you is a productive market garden and vegetable growing. And quantities of livestock which you can have access to and become involved in. So the invitation is to do something different. And what was quite interesting for me yesterday, I was working with an art therapist, and what came up in our conversation in the group was how colour, actually the palette of colours that are available in modern life now are so different to how they were 100 years ago. What we're subjected to in terms of colour in Britain, yeah, is very, very different. So in terms of stimulation, or maybe overstimulation, when you come into the farm landscape, actually again, the volume is turned down because you're not being overstimulated by colour, you're just receiving sort of natural hues, natural colours, natural pigments, and there's something in them which allows you to feel a lot more relaxed. In fact, when I show parents of prospective students around, or a local authority commissioner around, they say, oh, I feel so relaxed here, immediately. Yeah? Because they walk into a landscape which actually allows that to happen. So the young person is invited to participate in something which they probably never considered they could participate in. And it's not easy work, because actually to separate yourself from your image, to coming in and saying, well, actually, we're going to dig today, is a big ask. It's a really big ask. But the place tells us, we've asked permission in a way, and the place tells us that that's what we can do. And that we can run a farm there with sheep, and we can run a farm there that has Gloucester cattle there, because there's a history of those also in that place. And that we can keep the traditional breed of pig, and we can grow an orchard of local Gloucestershire varieties of apples, for example, because the pig and that orchard have a symbiotic relationship with each other historically. So our curriculum is built out of this, what emanates from the land historically, but also into inviting the young person into learning some practical skills. And our method is, we've named it Practical Skills Therapeutic Education. And it's our value point, it's what we do as an organisation. So, to come and be asked to dig can be quite a challenge. Because, again, you're asking a young person to come away from what, to all intents and purposes, is a sterile environment, and to stick their hands in the earth. And that's very challenging for a lot of people. And when you meet resistance, that's actually the most fantastic place to start to build a relationship. No, I won't, is met with, well, yes, you can. Yeah, you can do this. And so the kind of inner condition of the staff is also very, very important. So the inner condition of the gardener and the grower is one of what we would call a kind of contemporary apprenticeship learning, where the tutor recognises that they have to learn as much about the student that stands before them as the student is going to learn from them. So there's a relationship which is formed there. And there's no emphasis on thou shalt. The emphasis is on you can. It's here if you want to. I'm going to do it anyway. And I'd really like you to come along and help me. And while we're doing this together, we can have a conversation about how it is for you. Yeah. So that moment of asking the student, the young person, to dig is often met with resistance. The possibility is then to kind of is to meet the young person halfway and to say, well, actually, we're not going to dig then. What we're going to do is we're going to reduce the size of the tarts and the garden. We're going to take it into a polytunnel. And onto some staging, and we're going to sow seeds. And actually what I'd really like you to do is to sip some compost, because there's a good chance that actually the young person, if they're ASD, has got a bit of a compulsion about dirt, being dirty, touching things they don't like to touch. So give them a sieve, and they'll sip some compost, and they'll pop some seeds into a seed tray, and there'll be 100 seeds of lettuce sown, for example, and they'll water them and you'll put them to one side and you're going to do something else. But actually what you've done is you've said, okay, I heard you, we're not going to dig, but you're going to meet me halfway. And you've created the conditions so that something else can happen, knowing that in 2 weeks' time, when they come back and they water again, that there's going to be some seedlings there. And in 3 weeks' time, they'll be in a position where actually they do need to go out and dig to be able to pop those lettuce plants in, or whatever it is that you're growing. So it's always about meeting the person and building a relationship through actually the work which is going to take place. And that's the method right across all of our curriculum. So the plant actually is a really interesting vehicle, shall we say, or maybe it's a transitional object for this young person. Because in a way, when you're so out of tune with the world, with the demands of the world, and you find it really difficult through your anxiety or your depression or your pathology to actually muster the strength or what we could call the kind of life forces to move yourself forwards, the plant actually represents so archetypically, life force. The potential of a seed and just simple conditions of moisture, darkness, warmth, soil, compost, something happens there. And the student actually sees that happen. And because they've had a hand in it, they've actually had an intervention themselves in making that happen, it becomes part of them. And an interest is kindled. So they move from a place of I won't to a place of I can, and a place of I'm interested. So to engage that young person then further becomes easier, because they've already seen some success. And of course, unconditional positive regard is another factor that we have to carry with us as staff. It's very difficult. It's very, very difficult, because you quite often, you've been spat at maybe, you've been sworn at, you just receive indifference sometimes. But actually, you will meet that young person week after week or day after day, and it's a blank page every single day. The possibility and the potential to do something for that young person, to actually perform something which is of value and of service, is always there. And what tends to happen is that becomes a reality. Because the most important thing is that you build a relationship of trust. And if you can imagine that with, especially with an attachment disorder, that trust has been kind of breached at an early point in life, and those relationships are very, very important, that those boundaries are pushed, and actually the young person sees actually my mentor or whoever is still there for me, despite my behaviour. And this is how relationships are built up. So the farm becomes a productive place for them. It's not just a productive place in terms of being able to grow a quantity of vegetables, which then can be harvested and put into our shop. It becomes a productive place in terms of the fact they can meet their peer group and they can build relationships, and they can learn about their own difficulty, and they actually become masters of their own difficulty. And that's a very, very powerful place, because in the past they've been told that they're bad, or they're naughty, or they're difficult, yeah? And that you can't do something. But what we do, actually, is we allow them to discover their own abilities to actually deliver service. And it's very, very much person-centred, and it's very, very much student-led. So the story of this young man that I started with is that actually he became so engaged in the garden, in the productive side of the garden, that he, on a Tuesday morning when the vegetables or the salad crops are being harvested and weighed to go out into the shop, which is a social enterprise, open to the public, he's able to do that, and he's able to get exact measurements and weights and meet an order sheet and ensure that there's the right amount of carrots, beetroot, whatever it is, Swiss chard, herbs, fruit, going over to the shop as it's ordered. And it's quite remarkable, because he's found a place of belonging. And then, so the garden is actually part of a larger organism. So it's a department of the farm, and that's quite unusual. It exists as part of the farm, and so the fertility for the garden comes from the animal activity over on the farm. So to engage students in the plants, they've kind of seen what life force is, and they've taken that on. When you start to engage young people in animal husbandry, they meet something else. And in the biodynamic organism, they meet a quality of care, I would say, that is quite unusual. They're not meeting animals as livestock units, as you would on a conventional farm. They're meeting animals as sentient beings that have needs and qualities that need to be nurtured and cared for. And also held within that is this idea that your cow, for example, the most important product from your cow isn't meat and it isn't milk. The most important product from your cow is actually the manure. So that kind of puts the cow in a completely different context. But also what happens for that young person is when they meet the work with animals, they also meet the resistance of the livestock. Because working with sheep, they don't want to be caught, they don't want to be handled. So they meet animal and animation obviously have a very, very close close link with each other. They meet these animate beings that demand will. They demand these kind of will forces and these acts of doing to actually take place. So if your life forces have been woken up by working with plants, to then actually do something against the resistance of something else is actually also a big demand of these young people. And what they experience is you can't leave a job with animals half done. And it's as simple, it really is as simple as that. If you're going to feed the animals, you have to feed them. If you're going to clip the sheep's feet, you've got to herd them all into a pen, and you've got to catch them one by one. You've actually got to learn how to clip their feet, how to restrain them. But you're doing it out of service. You're doing it out of nurture and for the good of the animal. So life and will are what these young people begin to learn. And the skills that they have to then embellish, really, or have to take on and then embellish, are really pertinent for them to be able to go forwards out into the world. Because you have to be very, very skilled to work a flock of sheep on your own. But to work in a group of people when you're when you have an autistic spectrum disorder is actually very challenging. But again, the sheep, for example, act as this kind of transitional object. You have to engage, and you have to communicate with other people, and you have to create a plan, and you have to work together, and at the end of it, you can all high-five each other because you've done a good job. Yeah, and reflect upon that, and actually go away going, do you know what, I did something with somebody else. And that's a whole new experience. And again, with the attachment disorder, you're working with your peer group, and you're building something of relationships with your peer group that maybe, and this does happen, that you can then start to think about how you're going to interact with them outside of the workplace. So what we're ostensibly working with is social skills, work skills, and the student beginning to recognise a sense of their own well-being within that. And this is all born out of biodynamic practice. And I think it's really important to name that, because of course within biodynamics, we're looking at the farm being a whole farm organism, that all the enterprises on the farm act as organs of the farm, and they all have a relationship with each other. So for those who are neurotypical, it's quite easy to kind of work that out. But if your experience as an autistic young person is that everything is fractured and nothing is related, to actually come into that environment whereby you meet an organism that functions, and that the care of the grassland and the permanent pasture actually has a relationship to the health of the cows and the sheep, and the health of the cows and the sheep then has a relationship to the manure which you collect and compost to put out onto the vegetables, which you then go and harvest and sell in the shop, or you go and harvest and you actually take home and eat in the evening. And the compost or the waste material from that comes back into the cycle, and suddenly everything is joined up for you. And what has been fractal actually becomes whole. And this is what I would say we experience in our students on a regular basis. So if I come back to the story of this young man, he then moved over to working on the farm, and he has become quite skilled at driving a tractor. You more or less ask him to do most of the things that the farm team need to do. He works alongside other students now without creating difficult relationships with them. It's not always perfect, and it's sometimes there's a little bit of regression. But something quite extraordinary actually happened with him. So if we think back to the beginning of the story where we were hearing about kind of serial self-harm, self-abuse, we did what we would call a student study. So the whole staff group get together, and we kind of, as professionals, we do an observation and a kind of, it's like a therapeutic hour where we discuss the student through a process. And what came out of that process was, well, this young man needs to make a sheepskin. He needs to make a sheepskin rug. And the process of making a sheepskin rug means that you send some sheep off for slaughter, which again, it's a very powerful moment, as you can imagine. And it's done with great reverence, I have to say. You bring back the sheepskins and they go into a tanning process. But before that happens, you take a hide and you place it on basically a wooden horse. And you take a knife, the blade, and you take that blade and you put it into flesh, into the skin. And you have to kind of just gently draw and cut your way through what's left on the skin, any flesh which is left on there. So you've kind of taken the phenomena of his self-harm and you've put it somewhere else. And he said, you know what, you're going to do this. Are you interested? Yeah, I'm interested, because he's already built all these great relationships and he's nurtured the sheep all the way through from lamb to slaughter. And a very remarkable thing happened. He learned how to tan hides. He then decided that he was going to buy all the skins back up at the butchers from the sheep that we sent off for slaughter. And he set himself up a little social enterprise because he learned how to do this. And what was remarkable was I turned up, because I don't work on the farm anymore, but I turned up on the farm and there he was. And he employed another student to work for him. And he had two of, my biodynamic trainees, who also work on the farm, working for him. And they were washing the finished product, thankfully, with ecological detergent. You know. So he was really seeing the whole ecology of the operation through. And so he'd kind of gone from being this sort of social burden to being a social entrepreneur through the vehicle of his learning on the farm. And his sheepskins are for sale now. In fact, I've ordered one for them. Mm. Yeah. And he has now got a completely different picture of himself to who he saw when he first came through the farm gate, or through the college gate rather, 2 years ago. Completely different picture, because he can see possibility. And there was also something else quite remarkable about him. Quite often I've received kind of groups of people who need to be shown around the place. And I was working with some, there must have been agricultural visitors from somewhere, I can't remember where they were from. We got to the bottom pasture of the farm. And there was this young man dismantling a woodshed that needed to be taken down. And he just wandered over to go and see who the group were. And he could hear what I was talking about, and he just butted in. It was great. It was a real classic moment. And he was able to actually tell this group of visitors the whole fertility cycle of the farm. And I didn't have any idea that he had learned this at all. Yeah, but he was able to actually tell these people the carbon cycle and the nitrogen cycle of the biodynamic farm as he saw it. And it was absolutely spot on. It was really accurate. So he's a case in point, but he's also, there are others as well. His picture of himself is completely different. And he, you know, if we were to interview him now, he would probably be able to tell us that he can imagine himself working or running a business, certainly living independently, which none of that would have seemed possible when he first came through the college gates. So he's gone through a sense of belonging to a place, to a particular landscape. He's learned practical skills. He's become part, I would say, of the biodynamic ecology. He's not separate from the farm operation, he's part of it. The farm organism and the attitude of regeneration, which actually comes from the staff and from the land itself and the operation, and the actual acts that he's learned to perform have been deeply, deeply therapeutic upon him. So we have our spirit of place, our practical skills, our biodynamic ecology, and a therapeutic approach, all working in a kind of symbiosis with it. And all of our other students is just our example for this afternoon. And what he's also seen role models on the farm is something of care and support in a holistic way, because actually the animals are treated holistically. They're given space to be what they need to be. The horns are kept on cows, for example, because cows are supposed to have horns. Pigs are given outside areas with wallows and huts to live in. And we're kind of generating a small wooded area for them. They're just allowed to be. Same with the sheep. So he sees that there's a kind of holistic approach to kind of the growing of livestock and the care of the livestock. We employ homeopathy, we make herbal remedies for the animals rather than going allopathic whenever we can. So our fields of practice are actually amplified on the farm, or exemplified on the farm for our students. And then something very interesting, I would say, happens. We talk about in our seven fields of practice within Ruskin Mill our transformative leadership and management. And it's something as a member of staff, you really want to have a transformative kind of approach to management. You want to be given the opportunity to kind of self-manage and to make sure that what you do is effective for your learners or for the people, the staff group that you're working with. But it's also for the young people that we work with to kind of see the possibility of their own transformation and their own self-leadership. So to actually come into college every day is a remarkable thing for somebody who has spent 3 years prior to coming to us, doing nothing, being lured by a culture which is very chaotic for them. It's an example of transformative leadership, when you can actually take your own destiny and turn it around. And that's very much what the work of Ruskin Mill Trust is about, in that we have a strapline that says reimagine the potential. And it's in the same way that every seed has potential, every young person has potential. Every member of staff also has potential. So what we're really looking to do is to take a holistic approach to agriculture and kind of lift it out of the ground. Yeah. So we're not about how many kilos of carrots can you grow. Yeah. Although we are. On one level, because we need those carrots in our shop and in our students' nutrition. But actually what we're really about is what's the affordance of the carrots that we're growing? What is this young person gaining by being part of that piece of production, or learn how that carrot fits in to the whole picture of the farm? Yeah. So I could really talk to you. Have you got any questions? Yeah. Let's open it up for us.